each question. Then make sure that you have your answer. The type will be in the small question and answer box, which will be in the right side of your delegate screen. So make sure you open that question answer box and type in the answer. And make sure you also have correct profile name to your name. And the scorers will note down the person who answered the question correctly and first. Just make sure not. So like if you have multiple correct answers, the person who had answered the question first and the person who has answered the question correctly will be considered as the person who has answered the greatest number of questions first and correctly will be considered as the winners of the quiz. The scorer's decision will be final for selecting the winner. So I have Dr. Omayal Murugesan, my mom. She'll be the scorer for this event. So as the answers will be typed into the Q&A session, so we'll have a direct look into who's typing in the Q&A. So we also have noted everything.
One question for you for the tech support and Dr. Kunju Muhyiddin. So all the people who are logged in the delegates, do they have the access to the chat box, please?
Yes, madam. They have it on the front screen. Whosoever have logged in as a delegate, on the screen right-hand side, there's a tab that says Q&A. So delegate can type in the answers there once they see the question from Dr.
Okay.
Kumar.
Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Thank you, madam.
We have decided upon to have this because this is the most simplest way, and this way we could make maximum number of people participate. Having in a separate app to type in the answers, or this will be like will be difficult for people to log in through their cell phones. So like putting it in the Q&A will involve lots of people to participate in the question. So most of the questions are very simple. It is very fun and very knowledgeable also. And it'll be so like let us directly go into the first question. Okay. So please look it into the picture. So the first question is, identify the manure shown in this picture used for breech delivery. Option A is Morrissey's Millie wheat manure. Option B is Burns Marshall manure. Option C is Brack's manure. Option D is Lowsett manure. Let me repeat the question. Identify the manure shown in this picture used for breech delivery. Option A is Morrissey's Millie wheat manure. Option B is Marshall Burns manure. Option C is Brack's manure. And option B is Lowsett manure. Delegates, start putting in the answers for the in the chat Q&A box. Okay. So the response for first question is over. So let us look at the answer now. This is the classical Brack's manure. So it's usually the delivery of the fetal in the breech position by extending the legs and trunks of the fetus over the pubic symphysis and the abdomen of the mother, which leads to spontaneous delivery of the fetal head.
One second, Dr. Parneet, you have answered to me. You are supposed to answer it in the open chat box.
Huh?
He answered correctly, Dr. Parneet. But it was to me directly. Everybody has to answer to the open platform, not to anybody.
Yeah. So answer. Please answer the question.
The same chat box.
Yeah. Don't open chat box. Dr. Parneet had answered correctly, but he had answered to me.
Where to answer? There is no box apart from the chat box.
So.
No. Okay, ma'am. I was sorry.
There is no chat box.
I saw Dr. Parneet's answer. It was C, Brack's maneuver. Just at the close of the timer, but she answered it to my chat box. Yeah, that's so, what I'm saying for the tech support. Please make it very clear so that all the delegates and the faculty, whoever wants to participate, they know where to type it.
Yeah, so
we cannot see any, there's a question answer box.
So there is no question, just put it in your chat box.
So in that, when once you open through the delegate link, through the POGS link, that has been given. So in that, in the right hand corner, you will see a Q&A box. You have to type in the answer.
Let me make it very clear. The faculty members who have logged in through the faculty link, they can put their answers in the chat box addressing to everyone. Those who have logged in through the virtual platform or the as delegates, they can put their answer in the Q&A box. So that is the thing. In the delegate platform, it is known as Q&A box. And in the Zoom platform, it is known as chat box. That is the difference. Okay.
So we'll close the response to first questions. Moving on to the second question. Okay. This technique for delivery of the fetus in breech position with the fetal head in occiput posterior position, the operator delivers with one hand while making the pressure over the pubic symphysis with the other hand. What is the menu shown in the picture? Option A is Pinard's menu. Option B is Prax menu. Option C is Lausitz menu. Option D is Burns menu. Burns Marshall menu. So I'll repeat once again the options. The options A, Pinard's menu. Option B is a Prax menu. Option C is Lausitz menu. Option D is Burns Marshall menu. So we'll stop picking in the responses for question number two. So we'll so the answer. The answer is Prox menu. So the Prox menu is used to deliver the head when the breech is in the occipital posterior, where you hold the shoulders and of the baby and deliver it. Moving on to the next question. So question number three.
Just a second, sir. You need to give a little more time for delegates to submit their answers. Please give a little more time for delegates.
Sir, if the answer, correct answer is already there, actually. So we, beyond that time, we won't be giving more time. Go on to the next question, Dr.
Okay, so what is the size of this gray ventralon shown in this picture? 14 gauge, 16 gauge, 17 gauge, and 18 gauge. So it's actually option A, B, C, and D. 14 gauge is option A, 16 gauge is option B, 17 gauge is option C, 18 gauge is option D. So we still have like some 15 seconds remaining for this question. So time's up for the question number three. So we can stop taking in responses for question number three, and we'll go on to the answer for this question. So the option is 16G. So actually 14 gauge color code is orange, 16 gauge color code is gray, 16 gauge is green, and so on. Okay, moving to the next question, question number four. Identify the instrument used in this picture for management of postpartum hemorrhage. Option A is Bakri balloon. Option B is Foley's catheter. Option C is condom catheter. Option D is none of the above. So let me once again go through the question. Identify the instrument used in this picture for postpartum hemorrhage management. Option A is Bakri balloon. Option B is Foley's catheter. Option C is condom catheter. Option D is none of the above. Okay. So time's up for the question number four. So we'll stop taking responses for question number four, and we'll move on to the answer for question number four. Option A, Bakri balloon, is the answer for this question. So this is a classical looking Bakri balloon, which is used in for postpartum hemorrhage. Moving on to the fifth question. Identify the compression suture used in surgical management of postpartum hemorrhage shown in this picture. Option A is it's Heyman suture. Option B It's B, Lynch suture. Option C, it's Cho's suture. Option D, it's Matsubara Yano or MY suture. So let me once again go over the question. Identify the compression suture used in surgical management of PPH shown in this picture. Option A is Heyman suture. Option B is B. Lynch suture. Option C is Cho's suture. Option D is MY suture. So the answer for this, so time's up. We'll stop taking responses for our question number 5. So we'll see the answer for this. The answer is a Cho's square suture. So in this Cho's suture, what we'll be taking is we'll take square sutures going from A to B and C and D. So in this way, the both the anterior and posterior edges are opposed. So this is especially useful in like in placenta previa when the lower segment is bleeding and you could oppose the lower segment to arrest the bleeding. Okay, going on to the sixth question. The pregnant woman with epilepsy have the highest risk of breakthrough seizures during first trimester, intrapartum, postpartum, and the third trimester. So the sixth question is, pregnant women with epilepsy have the highest risk of breakthrough seizures during the first trimester, intrapartum, C, postpartum, and in the third trimester. We have like some 10 seconds more to get in the responses for the sixth question. Okay. So moving on to the answer. The answer is postpartum period is where the woman is at the highest risk of getting seizures. Because it is very obvious the woman needs, she'll be very tired. She will have, the baby will be continuously crying and she will be frequently need to breastfeed her baby. She'll have lack of sleep. And there's also a lot of biochemical and hormonal changes that are continuously occurring. And because of that, her seizures will be precipitated. Hello. Going on to the seventh question, a 27-year-old Gravida 3 Para 1 Live 1 Abortion 1 woman attends the emergency department at 37 weeks of gestation in labor with shortness of breath and wheeze. She has a history of asthma for which she takes salbutamol, salmeterol, and miclometasone inhalers. Which of the following medications is considered to be safe in use of women with asthma? A. Labetalol, B. Carboprost, C. Ergometrin, D. Prostaglandin E2. So let me repeat the question. So which of the following medications is considered to be safe in a woman with asthma? A. Labetalol, B. Carboprost, C. Ergometrin, D. Prostaglandin E2. We have like 10 seconds to get in the responses for this question. Okay, the time's up. You get the response for this question. So the answer is prostaglandin E2. So all the other drugs like labetalol, carboprost, ergometrin, all others have the potential to provoke bronchospasm. And prostaglandin E2 is said to be very safe in women with asthma. Okay, so moving on to question 8. After the cervix is fully dilated, which is the most important force in fetal head expulsion? A. The option is uterine contraction. B. Is intra-abdominal pressure. C. It's fetal head descending through pelvis. D. None of the above. So let me just repeat the question. After the cervix is fully dilated, what is the most important force in fetal expulsion? A, uterine contractions, B, intra-abdominal pressure, C, fetal head descending through the pelvis, D, none of the above. So we have 10 more seconds to get in the responses for this 8th question. So the time's up. So we'll stop taking in responses for the 8th question. So we'll move on to the next question. The answer for this is B, intra-abdominal pressure. So that is the reason why only after full dilatation and when it's nearing the throat, we should ask the woman to strain. So because for the fetal head to extend and expel, intra-abdominal pressure is very important. Okay. So going on to the 9th question, which of the following statements about the photo provided above is false? Okay. A, this is a product of rapid labor. B, this can make it difficult to assess the sutures and fontanelles. C, most of the time, these changes to the fetal head shape will resolve within a week of delivery. D, these changes to the fetal head can facilitate a vaginal delivery in a woman with a contracted pelvis. So the following statements about the photo provided is false. A, this is a product of rapid labor. B, this can make it difficult to assess the sutures and fontanelles. C, most of the time, these changes to the fetal head will resolve within a week of delivery. And D, changes to the fetal head can facilitate a vaginal delivery in a woman with contracted pelvis. Okay, so we'll stop taking in responses for 9th question. So the answer is, this is a product of a rapid labor. It's false. So usually a cap coat happens in a
I'm sorry to interrupt you, dear Anit. We want to finish all the questions. So just give the correct answer and next go on to the next. Otherwise, questions pure nahi kar payenge, dear. Sorry, yeah.
So the WHO organization has proposed labor management program in which protraction is defined as dash centimeters per hour of cervical dilatation for a minimum amount of dash hours. So this is from the recent Williams obstetrics books. So the WHO has proposed the labor management protograph in which protraction is defined as dash centimeter per hour in cervical dilatation for a minimum of dash hours. So we have 10 more seconds to get in the responses for this. The answer is C, 1 and 4. Let us move on to the 11th question. What is the name of this hydrostatic method used in acute inversion of uterus? So have a look at this picture and what is the method that is used? The option is option A is O'Sullivan's method. Option B is Huntington's method. Option C is Haltain's method. And option D is Johnson's method. So I'll repeat the question. What is the name of this hydrostatic method used in acute inversion of uterus? Option A, O'Sullivan's method. Option D, Huntington's method. Option C, Haltain's method. And option D, Johnson's method. We have 10 more seconds for responses for this question. And after that, we'll stop taking in responses. Okay. So answer for this is O'Sullivan's method. So we'll move on to the 12th question. Which statement concerning the following labor complication is true? This is a composite presentation. B, the forearm is frequently injured in this presentation. C, in most cases, the infant will deliver vaginally without difficulty. D, the infant will sometimes withdraw its hand if pinched by the delivering obstetrician. So you could see the head, it's a full dilatation, head is crowning, and just the fetal hand is just above the head. defeat. So which of the following labor complication is true? This is a composite presentation. The forearm is frequently injured in this presentation. So the most cases, the infant will deliver vaginally without difficulty. The infant will sometimes withdraw its hand if pinched by the delivering obstetrician. So the answer for this question is C. So in most cases, the deliver, infant will deliver generally without difficulty. Okay, so moving on to the 13th question. This is a 24-year-old primie of 41 weeks of gestation undergoing induction of labor. She's currently on intravenous oxytocin and the reports abdominal pain that is not relieved by epidural. The nurse calls you for the fetal heart rate pattern seen below. What is the likely etiology? Option A is fetal heart block. Option B is rapid fetal descent. Option C is placental abruption. Option D is maternal hypothermia. So what is the what could be the probable reason for such a CTG? Option A is fetal heart block. Option B is rapid fetal descent. Option C is placental abruption. Option D is maternal hypothermia. We have 10 more seconds to get in the responses for this question. Okay, so there we'll stop the responses for question number 13. The answer C is placental abruption. Okay, moving on to the 14th question. Among the following fetal scalp pH, which is considered as abnormal? Option A is 7.24. Option B is 7.19. Option C is 7.35. And option D is 7.25. So among the following fetal scalp pH, which is considered as abnormal? Option A, 7.24. Option B, 7.19. Option C, 7.35. And option D, 7.25. Okay, so time's up. We'll stop taking in responses for question number 14. So the answer is 7.19. So anything less than 7.20 is considered as abnormal. Moving on to the 15th question. Which of the following is true for fetal scalp stimulation? So accelerations predict a pH of more than 7.2. Cannot be used in preterm infants. Lack of acceleration predicts a pH of less than 7.2. Cannot be used as a substitute for fetal scalp blood sampling. So whenever we see an abnormal fetal CTG, what we'll do is we'll just, you know, stimulate the fetal scalp. So that is called the fetal scalp stimulation. So among these, which is the true? The accelerations predict a pH of more than 7.2. Cannot be used in preterm infants. Lack of accelerations predicts a pH of less than 7.2. Cannot be used as a substitute for fetal scalp blood sampling. We have like some 5 more seconds to get in the responses. Yeah, so time's up for this answer. So the answer for this is A. Accelerations predicts a 7.2. Suppose if you see a bad CTG and when you stimulate the scalp, you get an acceleration. That means the baby is not ischemic yet. Okay. The image shown is device which is used for. Like look at the image. And what is the this device used for? It is used in PPH management. It is used in labor management. It is used in cervical suture. It is used in fourth degree perineal tear. So the image shown in the device, which is used in for, it is used for PPH management, labor induction, cervical suture, fourth degree perineal tear. So yeah, we time is going to get over. So we'll stop taking responses for 16th question now. The answer is B. It's used for labor induction. So this is a dynaprostan vaginal vessary. And now we have a commercial available called Propus, which has a 10 milligram pessary in India right now. Okay. So the WHO classifies genital mutation into four categories, which is the following descriptions are true. Type 1 is partial or total removal of the clitoris or prepuce. Type 2 is partial or total removal of the clitoris and labia minora. Type 3 is partial or total removal of labia minora and or majora and infant ablation without clitoridectomy. Option D is all of the above. So among these genital mutation, which is the correct type? So time is going up. So we'll stop taking in responses for question number 17. The answer is D, all of the above. These are the four. FGM is not quite common in our country, but it is quite common in African and certain parts of other parts of the world. So question number 18. Okay, a 25-year-old woman, Gravida 2, Para 1, Live 1, presents in spontaneous labor at 40 weeks of gestation, a cephalic presentation in a second pregnancy, having one previous normal birth. At the onset of second stage, she ruptures her membranes and the fetal heart decelerates immediately. On vaginal examination, confirms an umbilical cord prolapse with the fetal head in direct occipital posterior position below the level of spines and in full dilatation. What is the optimal management? A. Digital elevation of fetal head and category 2 cesarean section with vaginal anesthesia. Bladder filling will displace the fetal head and replacement of prolapsed umbilical cord. Immediate operative vaginal delivery with N2 extraction. Category 1 C-section under general anesthesia. So if you go by guidelines, the option will be C. So we should follow immediate operative vaginal delivery with N2 extraction because that will be the most quickest way of delivering the baby with a full dilatation, direct occipital to posterior baby. Okay. So going to the question, 19th question, a 20-year-old primary gravida who would delay in second stage of labor, when would you abandon an attempted N2 delivery? Option A, if the cup comes off after one failed pull. After B, if a failed first application of the cup. Option C, if cup comes off after a second application. When option D is when there is no evidence of progressive descent with moderate traction during each contraction. So let me repeat the question. 19th, a 20-year-old primary gravida who had a delay in second stage of labor, when would you abandon an attempted N2 delivery? If the option A, if cup comes off after one failed pull, option B, after a failed first application of the cup, option C, if the cup comes off after a second application, option D, when there has been no evidence of progressive descent with moderate traction during each contraction. So the time's up for this question. So we'll stop taking in responses for 19th question. The option correct answer for this question is option D, when there has been no evidence of progressive descent with moderate traction during each contraction. Okay. So question number 20, when conducting breech vaginal delivery, what manure should be used in delivering the arms? B, Brack manure, Lausitz manure, gentle traction of the arms. Option D, Marusius Milli wheat manure. Let me repeat the question. What manure should be used in delivering the arms? Option A, Brax. Option B, Lausitz. Option C, gentle traction of the arms. Option D, Marusius Milli wheat manure. We have like 10 seconds more to get in the options and then we'll stop receiving options for option 20, question 20. So the option is very obvious. It's Lausitz manure. Okay. Moving on to question number 21. 27-year-old comes to your clinic for counseling. She had three mid-trimester miscarriages. And the last two failed a vaginal cerclage. One was a Sirodhkar, another was a McDonald's suture. When she was examined at a class clinic visit, there was a very little vaginal cervix. She is now 8 weeks pregnant. What would be the approach to minimize the risk of miscarriage in this woman? Option A is repeat Sirodhkars at 14 weeks. Option B, offer an abdominal cerclage for this gestation. Option C, offer a transabdominal cerclage at 10 to 11 weeks. Offer serial, option D is offer serial ultrasound scan and insert the Sirodhkar suture when the cervix is less than 15 millimeter long. So you have 10 more seconds to receive questions for this, responses for this. Yeah. Time's up. So the answer is offer transabdominal cerclage at 10 to 11 weeks. C. So it's best to place the transabdominal suture at 10 to 11 weeks is what the research states in a patient who has multiple failed previous sutures. So question 22, a 40-year-old woman gave birth to a fifth child 15 minutes ago. She has suddenly complaints of shortness of breath. In the next few minutes after delivering, she collapsed. The blood pressure is 70 over 30, oxygen saturation is 88 on air, and pulse is 75. Her arms have started to twitch. There is heavy vaginal heavy bleeding vaginally. What is the likely cause of collapse? Option A is amniotic fluid embolism. Option B is cardiac disease. Option C is hemorrhage. Option D is sepsis. So we have like 10 seconds more. So this is a question about a woman who collapsed immediately after delivery and she has reduced saturation. So what could be the possible cause? So we'll stop taking in responses for question number 22. It is amniotic fluid embolism. Okay, question 23. A 20-year-old Gravida 1 para 1 presents to the emergency room 10 days after an uncomplicated vaginal delivery, complaining of fever, nausea, vomiting, abdominal pain, and increased vaginal discharge. On arrival, she is febrile and has a fundal tenderness on exam. Which of the following tests would be least, which should be helpful for her further evaluation? A complete blood count, basic metabolic profile, a transvaginal ultrasound, Gram stain of vaginal discharge. So read the question properly. Which is the following test would be least helpful for further evaluation in this woman? So the answer is a simple Gram stain of the vaginal discharge will not give much of an information. So all the other tests must to rule out sepsis, foci of the pelvic sepsis. Okay. Question number 24. A secondary postpartum hemorrhage is defined as uterine hemorrhage occurring during which what time frame after delivery? So according to the definitions, what is the definition for secondary PPH? 24 hours to 6 weeks, 48 hours to 6 weeks, 24 hours to 12 weeks, 48 hours to 12 weeks. So secondary PPH is defined as uterine hemorrhage occurring during what time frame after delivery? 24 to 6 weeks, 48 hours to 6 weeks, 24 hours to 12 weeks, 48 hours to 12 weeks. We have 10 more seconds to get in the responses. Okay, so let's stop taking response for question number 24. So the option question answer is option C. It is 24 to 12 weeks of a delivery. Okay. So question number 25, your patient presents 5 days postpartum with an axillary mass. She noted it during pregnancy, all the reports, it is very much smaller. Yesterday, she noticed the mass becoming larger and more tender. Her face is shielded and sagittal photograph of breast and axilla and arm is shown. She denies any fever and has no additional complaints. Management of the patient should primarily include which of the following options? A, needle aspiration, B, observation and reassurance, C, axillary lymph node excisions, D, antibiotic therapy with gram-positive coverage. Yeah, time's up. The option is B, observation and reassurance. This is an axillary breast that has swollen with milk during breastfeeding. You just have to observe and reassure. Let's go to question number 26. A 30-year-old Gravida 1 para 1 complains of difficulty in ambulation on the postpartum day 1 following labor and delivery course, which lasted 24 hours and included 3 hours of pushing since stirrup. You perform an exam and note a bilateral foot drop on exam. The injury to what nerve is most likely the cause of patient's ambulation difficulty? A femoral nerve, ilioinguinal nerve, common peroneal nerve, lateral cutaneous nerve. This is the nerve that you get injured when you put in a lithotomy position for a long time, not only in during delivery and also in hysterectomy, vaginal hysterectomies, lap hysterectomy, and so on. What is the nerve that gets injured when you're putting in lithotomy for a long time? A, femoral nerve, B, ilioinguinal nerve, C, common peroneal nerve, D, lateral cutaneous femoral nerve. Okay, so the time's up. We'll stop taking responses for question number 26. The option is C, common peroneal nerve. We will start taking question 27. A 29-year-old para 2 live 2 on 18-hour long labor hour course, unable to avoid 5 hours following vaginal delivery. What is the best management option? A single in and out catheter, place a Foley's catheter for 24 hours, continue close observation without intervention, encourage increased fluid intake since bladder is likely empty after delivering. So after an 18-hour labor course, is unable to avoid 5 hours following vaginal delivery. What is the best management? Single in-out catheter, place Foley's catheter for 24 hours, continue close observation without intervention, encourage increased fluid intake since bladder is likely empty following delivery. So we have 10 seconds to get in the responses. Okay, so the answer is... B, place a Foley's catheter for 24 hours. Moving on to the 28th question. 33-year-old Gravida 4 para 3 live 3 at 35 weeks of gestation presents to labor and delivery with a small amount of vaginal bleeding. When you place her on a fetal monitor, there's a sudden prolonged deceleration type of fetal heart tracing. An emergent cesarean delivery is performed. The 1 minute and 5 minute abgars are 0 and 3. Respectively. What is the following is the etiology? Vasa previa, placenta previa, placental abruption, D, all of the above. So I've just given a hint in this picture. So what will be the reason where a small amount of vaginal bleeding will cause such a rapid deterioration? Could it be vasa previa? Could it be placenta previa? Could it be placental abruption? Or could it be all of the above? Yeah, so the answer is vasa previa. So vasa previa, the bleeding is from the fetal side and even a small amount of bleeding could cause such bad decelerations. Okay. Question number 29. 25-year-old para 2 live 3 has one episode of seizures. Her blood pressure is 180 over 110 millimeter of mercury, 4 plus proteinuria. She then has a 5-minute tonic-clonic seizures which resolves with magnesium sulfate administration. What is the most likely finding on this imaging? A, subdural hematoma, B, parenchymal hemorrhage, C, subarachnoid hemorrhage. D, posterior reversible encephalopathy syndrome. So what does the MRI show in women with eclampsia? So A, subdural hematoma. B, parenchymal hemorrhage. C, subarachnoid hemorrhage. D, posterior reversible encephalopathy syndrome.
Dr. Anit, you will be stopping at 30 questions, no?
Yes, sir. Last question is there. So time's up for 29 questions. So we're moving on to the option D, posterior reversible encephalopathy is the correct answer for this question. So this is the last and the final question. Ligation of the following labeled vessels in the retroperitoneum will decrease the pulse pressure in the uterine artery. Option A is posterior division of internal posterior division, internal iliac artery, internal iliac vein, internal iliac artery, and external iliac artery. So option A is posterior division, option B is internal iliac vein, option C is internal iliac artery, option D is external iliac artery. The time's up. So the option is internal iliac artery. Thank you.